So you take the case in West Bengal, right? If you ask the parties concerned, the private party will tell you, if we were left to aggregate the land to build this particular plant, it would taken us so long we'd never do it. You say, you want a plant in West Bengal? You, the government of West Bengal, please help us aggregate the land. So the government of West Bengal started aggregating the land, but the basis on which they aggregated, the compensation that they ended up paying to the parties concerned, was politically unacceptable. Hence, you have this conflict.
So, Ashok, you are one of the authors, and I think you are an expert in the compensation part of it. Why don't you tell us, how do you devise the compensation package?
When we value the compensation, we value what? Actually, the ownership. But we do not value the usership. How this land has been used, and how it has contributed to the livelihood of that particular person or family. That is one complication. The second complication is the locational value of the land. Suppose you are towards the road head or with a better location which generally enhances the value of the land. Third is the attributes when it comes in, when the, suppose there is a project which is going to come in that place, immediately the speculative effect comes in. That's why it becomes very, very difficult to compensate on the basis of that.
See, I think you need to kind of come to the India-specific factors.
Right.
See, land in the very best of economies is not a perfect market. Land markets are not perfect. But in India, even the markets as they would have been do not exist. They have been highly distorted for a variety of factors. So therefore, even though the law provides for, let us say market compensation, it's a compensation of a highly distorted market, which is guaranteed not to give any value to the farmer or whoever the poor guy is whose land is getting aggregated.
Right.
Okay? Now we need to understand this very carefully. First of all, there are a whole host of regulatory arbitrages. You know, what I mean by that is de facto regulatory taking. You know, somebody cannot use his land for anything other than agriculture. And he's forced to part with it.
Right.
Once he parts with it, it can be used for everything else. So the difference in the value simply jumps up and it all goes to the aggregator. So obviously the guy who's giving up the land feels cheated.
So let's talk about the second part of it, which is the relocation, rehabilitation, RR.
There are actually five different ways of looking at that aspect. Firstly, there is the physical rehabilitation. I have paid something to give up my land. I therefore need to be compensated in some manner with another way to look at where I can provide shelter. Second is that there is a social angle to that as well. People are living in communities, right? So if communities are going to be rehabilitated, we have to ensure that the social fabric does not undergo too much change,
right?
There is also the psychological aspect of that kind of change, which also needs to therefore be taken care of, right? There is the fourth and probably the most significant one, which is the economic rehabilitation, where livelihoods become the key critical element to focus attention on. And the fifth is really to say that this compensation that we are making must be sustainable so that this kind of transaction is not a one time and then gone completely, right? So we have to make sure that there is sustainability built into the kind of income stream or revenue stream that we can look at. So these are all the aspects of rehabilitation resettlement. Yeah.